Jericho from Capital Extra for the Bass Music Awards. We've come down to the West End to give Sigma their award for this year. They've been busy boys, so let's see what they've been doing.
Held down heaven now, living in the same town, trying to find something new. Broken picture frame, I've been frozen in, trying to find a better view. This ain't me, this ain't cool, this ain't what I signed up to.
All right, it's Coco here for the Bass Music Awards, and today I'm joined by Sigma, Cam, Joe, because the public have voted you Best Producers of 2014.
Whoop.
Congratulations.
Wow, check that out. This is the only award we've ever won, I think.
Which leads us on very nicely to the fact that it's been an amazing year. Congratulations, you smacked it. Two massive global number ones. Like, this time last year, would you have expected this was going to happen?
No, not at all. I mean, you know, we were in the studio the other day with the guy that we sort of recorded the Rude Boy vocals with, and he was saying it wasn't that long ago. We're in the studio and we kind of didn't really know what we were doing. You know, we had tunes, but and then suddenly Nobody's Love just kind of came out of nowhere, and it just went bang, and everything's just gone mental. So yeah, we had no idea. It's kind of all just taken us a bit by surprise, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, we were having conversations probably around the same this time last year about potentially like giving up. Because we've been doing it for so long, and it just felt like people weren't picking up on what we were doing. And I think it's from other producers that we've spoken to that have been in a similar situation where they've come through and smashed it. They've almost everyone that we've spoken to, they've got to the, almost like the end of their tether with it, and then suddenly something just happens and it clicks. And yeah, which is what happened to us this year, which was great.
It's wonderful, the universe sorting us out. I mean, like the Nobody to Love. I mean, I remember getting sent that and it was like, oh, it's a bootleg. So were you like planning to give it away or something? And then you were like, oh, rah, something's happening here.
Yeah, we did give it away for free on our website originally. And then we just basically obviously sent it to a few DJs to see what their reactions were. And Annie Mac loved it. I think, I can't remember what the reply to the, when we sent it as an email, she was like, oh my God, this is amazing. And then kind of just spiraled from there basically. So yeah, big up Annie Mac, because she was one of the people that was instrumental in making that track happen, which is really nice.
As was the Clubber's Guide on Capital Extra.
Of course, yeah.
Absolutely, yeah.
Instrumental, guys, come on. So, I mean, I'm going to, just a little boring little comment because I'm weirdly interested in it. Clearing the sample with Kanye, was that an issue or was it just like...
It wasn't, I mean, I think there've been like a lot of difficulties around that track from Kanye's perspective, because I think he's going through a whole lawsuit with it in his side of the fence, because they sampled something else and it was all kind of quite blurred in terms of like the legalities of it. But from our perspective, what we actually ended up doing was it's basically a cover version. So there's no actual samples in there. It's all recreated, re-recorded, the vocals re-recorded.
Oh.
So it's an original track essentially, but like a cover version. So yeah, there's no legalities.
Clever.
Yeah, that's
like
it.
That. And now you're working with, you know, like proper vocalists, Paloma Faith. I mean, when I heard that that was a thing, I was a bit confused. How did that happen? I mean, she smashes it. She sounds amazing on that track. But how did Sigma come to hang out with Paloma?
We weren't really hanging out with her before. It's not like we suddenly became like, had number one, suddenly we're just hanging out with Paloma or anything like that. But I mean, yeah, we'd done a kind of version of the track Changing, and it had Ella Eyre on it. She'd co-written it, and I think at the time she was kind of trying to push her own solo career, you know, and she's got an album and all that kind of stuff, so it didn't really fit in with the timing of what she wanted to do. Mm-hmm. So we needed to look for someone who could sort of stand up to the vocals of Ella, which obviously is no mean feat, because she's amazing. Yeah, and also someone that was probably not who you'd expect to be on a track, because we like to kind of throw a bit of a curveball sometimes so people don't expect it. So we kind of reached out, our management reached out to Paloma's management. She really loved the track, and it actually was the first feature she's ever done. So she did a great job with it, and yeah, really happy.
That's actually really interesting that you mentioned Ella, because for Paloma, even though her voice totally suits it, it's not something that it wasn't a vocal I was expecting her to deliver. Like, it was fierce. Mm. But yeah. Then that's Ella, isn't it? So are you going to work with Ella again? Is that something that's
going to happen? Yeah, we had a session with Ella a few weeks back, and we've written something that's quite cool. But yeah, I mean, you know, Paloma, she really delivered the goods. And we, to be fair, like, when the management mentioned that they were going to get Paloma to do it, we were kind of, because it was like something we'd spoken about, but we weren't sure if it was actually going to work. Do you know what I mean? And but then when we obviously heard her singing it, it kind of clicked. And as Cam said, you know, it's good to throw a curveball in there with the people you work with, just to kind of, I don't know, get people talking about stuff, I guess.
Yeah, totally. I was like, ooh, my parents have heard of Paloma Faith. Like,
I think that's the weird thing though, because it's like we've kind of crossed over like the people that like the tune from obviously the drum and bass demographic. To younger kids who kind of know Paloma from sort of being a bit quirky on TV and stuff, and then also parents who obviously have heard sort of more jazzy stuff. So it's kind of done this blanket coverage, which has been, you know, we didn't expect that really. So that's cool.
No, it worked out very well. It's like sort of one of those things that someone would mention in like a music boardroom, and everyone would be like, as if that's gonna work.
yeah.
Come on. But so well done, that was ace. What's the next movements for you guys?
Well, we're basically gone from doing loads of shows this summer. It's been almost insane how many shows we've done, to kind of getting back in the studio and trying to finish off an album, essentially. So, I mean, next year we're going to be looking at launching an album, launching a live show to go off the back of it, and obviously another single, which will probably be launched the album. So, yeah, I mean, we're kind of getting there. We're really happy with the way it's sounding, and we can't wait for it to get out there now. Because, I mean, it's been a long, well, I wouldn't say that long a process, but it's been a really enjoyable process. And yeah, it'd be nice to actually get out of there and for everyone to hear it.
Yeah, totally. So what's the next steps with your show then, with this live aspect? What are you planning on doing?
We're still actually in the process of planning it. I mean, we've got the first live show in December that's basically when we're going to launch it. In London, I can't remember the name of the venue, but yeah, somewhere in London. So I don't know, Google it and I'm sure it'll come up. But yeah, we're just working on how we're actually going to do it and how we're going to integrate it. This is obviously, we're going to get vocalists to come. But yeah, we don't want to mention too much about it at the moment, because it's not actually like fully sorted. So yeah, it might change.
Is this become like a new standard for sort of drum and bass genre? Because I spoke to Wilkinson recently and he's like, oh, I've got a live show, going to get drummer and all of that. Are you now within drum and bass, is it like, if you're not doing a live show, it's kind of like you're not going to be able to get to that next level?
Well, I think a lot of what it boils down to is obviously playing at the festivals and stuff, that it really helps you to get like a better slot on a bigger stage, do you know what I mean? And that's not the sole reason that we're going to do it. It's because we're quite interested just to, I don't know, just to try something different, because we've been DJing for years. But that plays a big part in it. And also, yeah, just as I just said, we just want to try and see how it kind of works out, because it's kind of, I guess it makes it a bit more exciting rather than just DJing week in, week out, which is fun still as well. But you know, I think you have to like throw yourself new challenges every now and then to keep yourself interested.
Totally. I mean, as artists, you've kind of got to expand your skills, because I guess when you start smashing it, it's like, oh, where do I go from here? You don't really want to kind of do like an Elton John spiral into depravity or anything. Not that he's deprived, but
that's yet to come, I think.
I think that will happen at some point.
TBC. Yeah. That's really exciting, guys. That's pretty much all I wanted to talk to you about. No offense.
That's cool.
What have you got planned for New Year's and Christmas and all that?
We have a show at Brixton Academy on New Year's Eve, which should be fun. And I think we've got something on Boxing Day. And then we're going to Fiji on the 7th to do a show there as well.
Oh, that's nice, isn't it?
So we'll hopefully get some sun on our pale skin.
Well, you can't handle the light right now.
So. I can't handle this light. This is false light. I like sun.
Well, good luck, guys. Good luck with your live show. Congratulations on your award for Best Producers.
Any final words about the ward?
Looks beautiful. Can't wait to add it to the collection of crap in the corner of the studio.
Oh, hang on, this is not crap. This is an amazing.
I wasn't dissing the award in any way, to be fair. It's great. And we're really happy that we've received it. It's just, usually it does end up amongst, and you know, we have like platinum plaques that are in the pile of crap in the corner. Yeah, so yeah.
Yeah, we don't actually have any room at the moment. So I mean, in the studio, it's kind of like we've got loads of equipment everywhere and we haven't even put the plaques up anywhere. But this will definitely be pride of place in the studio in front of the keyboard, so we can see it every day.